were born in India, a country where the divine presence is everywhere. How did you decide to become a scientist?
Well, I was very sold by the ideas of science from reading about Newton, reading about Einstein.
As you were a child?
As I was a child, and especially as I was a teenager. So that's how it happened. I became a materialist for a very long time. Although my earliest childhood experiences were quite spiritual. My father was a spiritual man. But that didn't keep for very long. Various circumstances happened also. I came outside of the influence of my parents. I had to live about 4 years without either of my parents in my life. So all these things led to the advent of materialism in my life, which probably was a good thing because I did learn quantum physics during that phase. And eventually it's quantum physics that brought in the changes in my consciousness.
And do you believe in God?
Yes, very definitely. I believe in God. I have contributed to the establishment of God as a scientific idea, verifiable scientific idea, which has been verified, in my opinion, already in the laboratory. And many more experiments will confirm this rediscovery of God within science. I have no doubt about it.
Yes, do you think so?
Yes.
People will be convinced at all?
Yes, I think that people can be convinced right now. Skeptics, it will take a while because they will be convinced only when God hypothesis gives us new technologies. Such new technologies are coming, but it's a bit slow because right now to get financial commitment towards developing these new technologies is not coming in profusion. But it will. And as it happens, even non-believers today will become believers because it's really a very useful concept for our society. Just take one aspect of it. When society was spiritual, which was true even 50 years ago, businesses followed ethics. Society generally valued ethics. Now society doesn't value ethics, businesses don't value ethics, and our society is only becoming worse for it. Everybody understands that there is a value crisis right now in our social systems, in democracy. Democracy is being undermined because of this value crisis. In economics, economics is being undermined because greed is so rampant in the way we practice businesses. The educational system, it's too geared to jobs rather than teaching people the basic meanings and values of their lives. Religions are moribund. They have joined the politics of power rather than pursuing meaning of life of people, the parishioners. So in this way, our social systems are falling apart. And this has to change. And when we realize that the new paradigm helps us to make changes that have to be made in order for us to survive, then the paradigm will shift.
Adam Smith, o pai da economia moderna, em sua mais famosa teoria, diz que a riqueza das nações resulta da atuação de indivíduos que, movidos apenas pelos seus próprios interesses, promovem o crescimento econômico e a inovação tecnológica da sociedade. O conceito, com certeza, ainda funciona. Riqueza gera cada vez mais riqueza e, em muitos casos, o que importa são os interesses pessoais. Mas a física quântica aplicada por Amit Goswami tem uma proposta um pouco diferente: agregar valores morais aos econômicos. O dinheiro continuaria sendo o principal, mas viria acompanhado das ações éticas de sucesso, poder e satisfação.
My contention is that the current system of capitalism is a bit short-sighted. Adam Smith, when he developed it, could not help it. Because at that time, it seemed like the right way to go, which is to consider only the material sector of our lives. But we have four sectors, not just material sector. Material world we sense, but we also feel the vital world, the energy world. We think the mental world. That's where our meanings come from. And we intuit the archetypal Platonic world, which I would call supramental, following Sri Aurobindo. This supramental world is the world of values. This is what we covet. But when we concentrate too much on the sensory world of materialism, we forget the emphasis on these subtle worlds. And so spiritual economics says that not only concentrate on material wealth, but don't forget this wealth of the subtle systems, subtle aspects of ourselves. So when we actively produce and consume the subtle aspects of our life, we get spiritual economics. What is surprising, I myself was surprised, that when we include this hierarchy of needs, to use Maslow's words, when we include this hierarchy of needs to include not only the gross material but also the subtle needs of ourselves in our business and industry, you can eliminate that boom and bust cycle of capitalism which has forever haunted our economies. We really can eliminate boom and bust and get a steady state economics by making productions and consumptions in the subtle dimension.
Yes.
Yes.
And you can even make more money like that.
And you can even make more money. In other words, people just don't understand that the subtle aspects is our aspects. This is human aspects. There is money in it too, because money is correlated to meaning. If we produce meaning, that eventually does produce money. In fact, if you ultimately ask, look at the advertisements of how material products are sold. Material products are not sold because of their material values. They are sold by pretending that they have meaning values. Of course, these meaning values are pretend values. They don't really enhance meaning all the time. But so long as you think that they do, like a big car, for example, gives you the meaning that you have been successful in your life, people follow these pseudo meanings, and that's how we sell material goods. But this is telling us something deeper about us. What we do care ultimately is not about the big car. It's about the feeling of being successful. But suppose you can generate a much bigger feeling of successful by giving a satisfactory pursuit of meaning in the arts, in music, in science, in creative enterprises of changing our businesses, then satisfaction would already come. Success would already come in these other enterprises. Then we don't need a big car to feel that I'm a successful man.
And positive thinking can help in this case to
Absolutely.
Fulfill our needs.
Absolutely. Materialism makes us very cynical, very centered on negativity. Thinking in terms of idealism always makes us feel positive. We feel good. We feel good when we are good to others. We feel good when we are good to ourselves and pursue meaning instead of money directly. Let the money come from our pursuit of meaning, in other words, instead of money coming from pursuit of meaningless matter.
And then you don't have to feel guilty about the money that you make, right?
That is the case in point. We don't have to feel guilty. Instead, we can feel satisfaction.
Let's talk about the movie, What the Bleep Do We Know? That film made a lot of success without many publicity. Why do you think that happened?
Well, the movie was successful because it touched a chord in people's lives. It touched a chord people have been feeling the same way as the heroine of the movie feels, that I'm helpless, my life is finished because I'm helpless, there is no hope. And then she encounters the idea that the world is not like that. It is not a conditioned world where you just go from one conditioned aspect to another conditioned aspect, and none of them bring satisfaction. She discovered that there is creativity in the world, because the world is made of possibilities. It's just that she has become stuck in always choosing the same old conditioned modes of behavior. So she decides to choose the quantum, and she finds enthusiasm again, she finds happiness again.